Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Bite-Sized PD today. We are going to be discussing how we can use Canvas annotations to really enhance demonstration of the literacy and the reading standards that are in the ELA science and social studies curriculums. So as a little intro, if you don't already know me, my name is Leslie Morris, and I'm the high school ELA specialist, and I also support our reading intervention programs in the secondary schools. So welcome. Oh, I hit record, so we know that. Okay, so here are our norms for today. Be focused. Please ask questions if you need to. And if you're trying this out, go ahead and email me and ask questions. I'm here to support you. Oh, I'm going too fast here. Oh, I skipped several slides here. Oh, goodness, y'all. Let me go back. Sorry. As a reminder, I'm using two screens here. So if you see me look over, I'm just looking over at my other screen. As a reminder, please mute your microphone. You can have your camera off or on. Of course, I love to see your faces. And if you have questions, please type it in the chat. And I will stop and go through questions that we may have. Okay, as a reminder, all of our professional development supports the MTSS framework. And we are really looking at this evidence-based academic priorities. Oops. So our learning intentions today are: I'm learning how to use Canvas annotations to access complex reading standards. And our success criteria are that you know the features that are available in Canvas annotations and that you create an assignment using Canvas annotations. So our agenda today, we're gonna first take a look at the literacy standards and kind of break down these complex literacy standards, look at what they're actually asking students to do and what kind of skills we need to assess. Then we're going to look at the Canvas annotations tool, and I'll show you how to use it. And then we're going to look at what it looks like for students and how they use the Canvas annotations tool. So, if we take a look at grades 9, 10 literacy standards, we have this similar standard from ELA Science and Social Studies. In ELA, it's the most complex because we carry the burden of teaching the standard, but it's also in Science and Social Studies. So I'm actually gonna start over here with Social Studies, and it's Literacy Standard 8. And it says that they need to assess the extent to which the reasoning and evidence in a text support the author's claims. So we're looking at author's claims, reasoning, and evidence. In science, this is assess the extent to which the reasoning and evidence in a text support the author's claim or a recommendation for solving a scientific or technical problem. So now we're taking it in the context of science and looking at they're proposing a solution to a problem. That's their claim. What reasoning and evidence do they use? So we're assessing that. In ELA, this is a little bit more detailed. So it's delineate and evaluate the argument and specific claims in a text, assessing whether the reasoning is valid and the evidence is relevant and sufficient. Identify false statements and fallacious reasoning. Sorry. So there's a lot compacted into this standard. And we might actually end up breaking up the standard over the course of a couple units, in order to be able to address all of it. But let's look at it a little bit deeper. And I'm going to use the ELA one because it's the most complex. But when you look at the content knowledge that students need to have, they need to know argument, what an argument is, but also what the argument is in that text. So that's going to change with every text that they read. They need to know what the claim is of the author. And in more complex texts that we're reading in high school, this claim may not be in the first paragraph. It may not be on the first page. So they really need to be able to identify that in the text. They need to be able to identify the reasoning that the writer uses and if it's valid reasoning. So they're evaluating that. They need to look at evidence and see, is it relevant evidence? Is it sufficient evidence? So they're really critiquing evidence at this point. They need to know false statements and fallacious reasoning as well. That's a lot of content that they need to know in the abstract. They need to be able to know how to identify it, and they need to also be able to understand it within the text that they're reading. So this is quite a deep task that we're asking them to do. Now, the actual actions that they're doing, their actual task is going to be to delineate, which means to describe in detail, evaluate, assess, and identify. So all of those come from this standard. So when we look at close reading, Kyleen Beers and Robert Probst, who wrote Notice the Note, Strategies for Close Reading, emphasize this, meaning whether it's scientific or aesthetic, whether it's a poem or a scientific report, happens during the interplay between particular signs and a particular reader at a particular time and place. What happens so often with really complex reading tasks is that we explain for students. We read a complex text and we explain. We often will summarize for students. We might point out the claim. We might point out the evidence. We might discuss it. And so when we're really talking about building meaning with complex reading, students are the ones who need to be part of that interplay. They need to look at the signs, and in this book, that's the things that they notice and that interplay that happens as we're reading. So the more complex the text is, the more we need to give room for students to interact with that text at a complex level. Now, because of the use of technology, we have the ability as teachers to use Canvas to our advantage to help students show us their thinking. And that's really the point of the reading standards, is that it's about showing us their thinking through identifying and evaluating, as well as the final product, which might be a discussion, it might be a written piece, but that's the delineate and analysis. So we need to see their thinking and we need to see their final product to really assess if students can access the complex text, if they can have, if they have really mastered these reading standards and they are deep. This is not a one-day lesson. This is something that we practice with a lot of texts throughout the year. We might start with more simple texts and gradually get more advanced and more complex in the texts that we use, whether they're information or literary, whether they're scientific, historical documents, primary sources, secondary sources. We're going to use these strategies to really assess literacy and reading that at that deep level. So let me show you what you can do in Canvas with student annotations. Now, if you're like me, you probably think of student annotations as underlining in circles and that's it. But there's more to it. We need to see their thinking. We need to see their process. And what's really great about using the student annotations, we get to see them identify because they underline and mark. We get to see their thinking because they can comment. We can see the end product because you can build in a space where they actually write and type and respond. So we can do it all in one document, and you as a teacher can see it all in one document. It's great. So this is a little screenshot of what kind of the top looks like and what it looks like in an actual assignment. So really quick, I'm going to go through the different tools that you can do And you're going to see an example from an assignment that I made up. I have a pretend mythology class. So, oh, I'm going too fast. Again, I click and click and click. Okay, real quick, before we go into the annotations, I just want to review what close reading is. Because it's not, I said it, but let me say it again. It's not just circling vocabulary words and underlining key details, okay? So Kylene Bears and Robert Post, this is what they describe close reading as. Observing carefully what the authors presented to us. To close read, you need to avoid imputing to the author any visions, arguments, or ideas that aren't evident in the text. And we do that as we interpret text and we put on our own arguments, our own opinions into the text. So when we're close reading, we need to make sure that we're not doing that. We need to avoid wandering away from the experience and thinking about our own experiences and our own subtext and our own ideas. And really, I love this fourth one, avoid parroting the judgments and interpretations of others for our own assessment. Unfortunately, this is what we do as teachers. We share our judgment. We share our interpretation. We share our ideas as a model. But unfortunately, we could be wrong. And more importantly, we are not putting the burden of the learning on students. They need to practice this. They need to wrestle with text. And that's how they do it by close reading, is that they participate in this process. So let's look at some of the ways students can annotate. And I want you to think about how you would use this in your own content area. So the first way is called point annotation. And this is what the icon looks like. And you can choose different colors. It will mark a spot in the PDF that you upload. And then students can make a comment and type their comments out. And I'm thinking of all the ways that I could use color to mean certain things. If I was a student, if I was a writer, if I was the reader, color means a lot to me. And it can really help me organize my thoughts and look at how the author is organizing their thoughts. The next thing is a highlight function. Pretty standard, but with this and with all of these annotations, you can click on this notebook icon and the student can write. And you'll notice now that this is a highlighter and it's in the color that I'm highlighting in. You can do free text annotation, which just means that you can type anywhere and it can be in the background. You can have a transparent background. You can change the size, the color, all of those various ways that a student can annotate that they used to be able to do with different colored pens. You can do a strikeout annotation where it puts a line through it and making a comment. I see this most frequently used with editing and revising in ways that you can cross out what you wanted to say or what you would say and then type in a new response in the comment. You can do a free draw, which is a way of highlighting or drawing lines. And I did this as an underline, but you can do a free draw in any shape. So this is where students could circle, they could star, they could put a question mark, they could draw a line connecting a text from one thing to another. And you can change color and the line weight as well and comment. And the last section is to do a box. It's called area annotation, where you can draw a box around certain areas, change the color and the thickness and make comments. So you can see kind of down here on the screen, this is a picture of various Greek gods. So I drew pictures around them and I identified them. So think about how you could use that to help build vocabulary, to check for understanding. I'm thinking like anatomy and all these various ways that you could use this kind of annotation. So let me launch Canvas and show you how on the teacher end you can do this. And then I'll show you what it looks like on the student end. So I don't even have Canvas up. So let me log in. And of course, because you're here, it's going to be slow. Let's go into my mythology class. I've already set up this assignment just to save time. I called it What is a Myth? Annotations. When you come in and edit, and you can see, you're going to first want to put in any sort of directions. So I made some generic directions here, highlight characteristics of a myth, two comments explaining, there are questions. You can use it that way, but if I'm using it in a really advanced reading way, this is for student learning. And so this is something that they're going to build with and build confidence with as they use it. You're going to do all your normal Canvas assignment stuff. When you go to submission type, you're going to choose online, and then you'll see student annotation. Let me cross that out. You can upload a folder, and I have one already here for you. And you'll see it here. You can do all your attempts and assignment. And I'm not going to hit save because I don't want it to change the student side. So I'm just going to hit cancel, but you would hit save. Now, when you look at it on your end, you're not going to see that document. You just need to trust that it's there. We can always go into student view to double check that. And so we can see here, here is the document. And I just pulled this from Newzella because I wanted to see what it looked like. I always try to include directions for how to use the student annotation just in case they don't know. So I have linked these in the PowerPoint for you on the last slide or second to last slide. So you can check that out. If I come over to the student view, I have created a student account so that I can demo things. So let me show you from a student side what this looks like. Now, I've already started this because I wanted to test some things out and make a how-to for you. So whenever our students, this is a different document than what I showed in the video. Oh, well, that's okay. We'll use this document. It doesn't really matter. Students can always come in and click try again. So I'm going to do a second attempt on the assignment. And the right PDF shows. So this is because I have changed the assignment from the first time I started it to the second time. So just know that won't happen to you. That just happened because as a teacher, I changed the PDF, right? So we don't want to change the PDF after students have started. But here you can see my examples that I used for the screenshots below. I'm going to come to the second page and just show you for students, when they click on any one of these, a submenu will come up right below on the left-hand side where they can choose different colors. And here we go. I can click on cultures. I can change it to blue. I can make a comment. Anytime I want to delete something, I can just hit that trash can. And then I can hit a trash can up here to delete the mark. It will say, are you sure? We're gonna say, okay. We have the highlight feature here, which is great. And then here's that icon of the notebook where students can click and add comments. When you add text, they can't add text out to the side. It has to be over the top of their document. And I'm just going to type in so you can see the box size is quite odd here because it is stopping at the end of the page, right? So I always tell students you need to start over on the left. And here's where you can change your size. You can make the background solid or transparent and change the color. And now when I type, there it will go. And it will automatically like return to go to the next line when they hit the end of the page. So they don't need to worry about hitting enter or anything. We have strike through right here. That's yellow. That's not real dark. Let's do a dark purple. Hopefully you can see that. The free form, let's do a dark color. Let's do orange, where I can circle. I can make connections and draw. So it's more of a free draw tool and students can just use underline. And then let me delete some of this. You'll notice that I did all of that in one click. And so it deleted the whole thing. That's something to know for students is that if they want this to be separate, then they need to click that check mark. And now when they do another underline and click the check mark, they're actually two different things. So I can come in and go back to my pointer and I can click this and delete it and it won't delete the second underline. That's good to know. And then here's our box where we can draw and comment. So while there's the technical how-to of how to use student annotations, what's really important is that students know why and that they're really doing that analysis and that in-depth consideration of what they're reading, that they're making connections. I can totally see this as PDFs of articles that we're going to have a Socratic seminar about. I can see this as primary source documents and trying to identify through different lenses what the author of the document is saying or the creator of the document. I can see this in scientific reports and using it digitally to make connections. So to help students, I've created a how to do annotations in Canvas. I've created a tango for you. So that's there. And I have it linked on this slide, step-by-step annotations for students. And then we also have the Canvas student guides. If you've never looked at these, they're really amazing. They are step-by-step directions for students on how to do whatever we need them to do. So it does walk them through a little bit different process because we don't use the assignments tab, but it shows them and numbers, here's all the different ways and all the different things that they can do. And then we'll show them how to submit an assignment. So I've shared both of those links for you to help you out with this. Oops. Anyway, try out student annotations and try to really focus instead of on a step-by-step to do, circle two things and star this and underline that, to really get students to use the comment feature to think about their own thoughts and the connections that they're making. And so that they can show that they can really analyze and evaluate what's happening in the text that they're reading. Thank you so much. Are there any questions? Okay, don't hesitate to reach out to me or any of your instructional coaches who know Canvas, and we can show this, test this out and try it with your students.